Are you going to repay over a period of time? Is it secured, unsecured? how are you going to record these terms? So these terms need to be recorded in a in an agreement, in a document. Yes, I think there is a standard form that the ministry has now put up, but in April last year the ministry has actually made it very flexible. So there are certain provisions that are standard that you need to sort of capture, but there are others that are flexible. As the things probably, what is happening is the Supreme Court has clearly written that any agreement which affects the rights of the shareholders needs to be incorporated. So unless it is incorporated in the article, it will not be recognized as valid. Because the article is the document that drives the company.
Right.
So as things are, every time you have an agreement which affects the rights of shareholders, you have to capture it in the articles. Or you have to change the articles. So that, in that respect, it is very flexible.
I have a question. Adam, having an arrangement with the company which will pay me a retainer for a certain period of time, after which if they decide, if we both decide to partner, then I would be a shareholder. I would be a director. Now in that case, I'm not paid enough to actually register that document. So,
register as in,
legally register it.
I mean, the way you register, when you buy a property, the way you can register.
Yes. So, how do I go
about that? I mean, just, first of all, all these agreements are not required to be registered, the way you register. As per law, only documents which evidence a change of interest in an immovable property, flat, bungalow, plot,
okay,
those are required to be registered. A shareholder agreement is not required to be registered. There is no mandatory requirement under law for that.
I am actually taking, giving this as a loan. My remuneration will be as a loan to the company.
Because are you a director?
I am not a director, I am an outsider right now.
Okay.
So they don't have a capability to pay me. That's why I am having an agreement with them. So they will probably pay me a little later, but they would be interested in it.
So that will strictly not be classified as, it's a private limited company.
Yes.
So, under the Companies Act, there's something, a term called as deposit. Any money sort of that is advanced to the company is classified as a deposit. Private limited companies are not generally allowed to take deposits. They are only allowed to take it from their director level. They cannot take it from a shareholder. They can take it from any other company or a director. I think what they are probably classifying yours is just an advance that they need to pay back for the services that they are giving. It can strictly not be a loan, but I'll have to come in. It will have to be looked at more closely to see how it can be structured. If they are going to allot you shares in future for this amount.
Not for this amount actually. But
for the services that
no, you... this I have to be paid because I am not giving my services free.
Right.
This is a trial period which we have to understand that it can be worked together in the long run.
Sure.
So I am going to be available for them for full time as an employee for this period. After which we decide whether I would be a partner, where I make an investment later. I would not make an investment.
So your fees which is getting accumulated will turn as an investment? Or
no,
you get that back and the investment arrangement is
separate? Investment is separate. That would be much larger than the fees.
So then there's two separate. The companies can anyways pay you as a salary for services. It will not be classified, it should not be in my view classified as a loan. It is just that you're being
serviced. It could be just an illegal agreement, it need not be registered. Just a written agreement?
Yeah, this agreement need not be registered at all. Under the Registration Act, which you know decides which agreement needs to be registered and which should not be registered, only documents which create an interest in immovable property is required to be registered. So even a shareholder's agreement amount, you never register. There's a stamp duty implication that you need to pay stamp duty, but you need not register that. Register being going to the register that we all do whenever we need a license or a lease agreement, and, you know, into us offices and get it. That is not required. You want to have it. I think since there is a payment that is due and payment to you after a period of time, you are absolutely right, it is better to have a document saying that you are providing services and in return for services you are going to pay X, Y, Z amount and it will be paid over a period of time. It would be advisable to document it, but there is no requirement of registering.
Yeah, but in this case, you know, combining both these cases wherein my fees are getting accumulated and which at a future date will culminate into a shareholding in the company. How does that?
That's slightly tricky because if you're providing services and you're getting. So basically, you're not getting fees. What you're saying is I'm providing services and return for it. Services that is. I'm getting shares allotted. That is allotment of shares for what we say under companies are consideration other than cash.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, it's for kind.
Mm-hmm.
There is a sort of a procedure under the company that you know you need to sort of have a valuation done. That if I'm granting you shares for the. Just for example, if I'm allotting you shares of the value of 1 lakh, just to be honest. There has to be some document evidencing that I have provided you services for 1 lakh. It's not as difficult as you can just have an agreement saying that this is the services that you bring. in an ordinary sense, I would have paid you 1 lakh rupees as fees for these services. In return of that, I'm going to pay you a lot. At the time of allotment, you just convert that, I mean, you just follow the normal activity for consideration other than cash.
But then the documentation doesn't have to be registered, right?
No.
Not even notarized.
No, notarized is never,
it's a formal agreement.
It's an agreement, it's stamped and signed. That's
so,
it.
Signed by the two parties, that's
absolutely.
About it. With some witnesses, what?
I'm just
asking.
No, I'm just saying, because this is a question that again was asked me many times.
That's right.
I don't know, there's a notarization act. Everyone keeps asking to notarize it. Notarization basically saying someone has signed it for me, but in this kind of agreement, you're signing a stamp duty paper.
Correct. You don't have to even have a stamp
paper. Stamp paper is required.
Stamp paper is required.
Or the stamp duty. I mean,
that's
for
right.
Shareholders agreement, the stamp duty is very significant.
Yeah. Share subscription, share allotment agreements, those are significantly high.
So, what then the document that you required in this case? The examples quoted by.
So, I'm working as a retainer. Like he, I'm working as a consultant.
Achha.
So, I get into an engagement with the company. So, there is no agreement which is registered. It's just a scope of work which we are deciding. It's a retainer.
It should be 500 rupees stamp paper. I'm classified as a service agreement.
That's
right. Okay. 500 rupees is a
service.
It might be those, sorry, I'll just complete it.
Sure.
Later on, if you are a shareholder,
later on it would.
It might be, and that would, might have a larger standard.
Absolutely.
In Maharashtra, it is 0.2% of the value of the consideration. So if I'm subscribing to shares of 10 lakhs, 0.2% of that value is the standard.
Okay. That's a mandate.
Under the Bombay standard, Maharashtra standard.
In some agreements on stamp papers, what weight do they hold in this one?
Without stamp papers, they hold absolutely no weight. Or they should not hold any weight. For an agreement to be enforceable, you need to have a stamp paper.
In case of founder agreement and while distributing share, we are two founders and the distribution of share must be based on money, time and scale, right? Who is putting how much money and who is putting how much time?
Exactly.
Or it's a mutual understanding between two founders, like I will take 50%, I will you take 50%, or I am putting money and time,
money.
And you are just putting money.
Shares can be given only for two things, either for cash or for something other than cash, but there is some effort in this matter. Shares cannot be given for free, shares cannot be given for any other reason, and a lot.
So the efforts and money must be same in case if I want to give 50% to the founder, co-founder.
Or at least you have to show that effort is the same as money. As I said, you can probably have some sort of document. If I'm putting 10 hours, and if the value of 50% of the share is 1000 rupees, just to give an example, I can show that 10 hours is equivalent to 1000 rupees. So there has to be a match of the effort with the amount of share that you're making.
Because in my case, I'm putting all the first money and the co-founder is paying monthly some amount to me. So he's matching 50% of what amount I'm paying.
But how are you allotting him shares? Are you paying him monthly?
It's just a proprietorship, right? No,
right,
no shares,
okay.
Yeah.
No, so as an example that we had, we can always say that the money put, the value of the shares is equivalent, the effort is equivalent to the value of the shares. There are some sort of document evidence.
But proprietorship, why should shares be?
No, no, I'm saying I am going ahead. Proprietorship is no, but tomorrow if they are
allotting. Tomorrow if they want to create a and in this case, I founder agreement can be done on the plain paper, not on the stamp paper, right?
No. Every agreement under law's degree has to be done on stamp paper.
Stamp paper.
Every agreement. Sometimes people sort of find a way out and say that some agreements may not be as important as the others. So in that scenario, from a very strict perspective, even your normal employment agreements are required to be on stamp paper.
So, so what must be the, I think, the good combination of share distribution? Because what I'm saying is, maybe I'll take 25% for myself, 25% for my co-founder, maybe 30% for the incoming investor, and 20% for
ESOPs,
right?
If you want to control the company, you should always have more than 50%. If you want to absolutely control the company, it should always be 75%. If you want to hold a minority stake and still control the company, then your shareholder agreement should have provisions that gives you rights to control. But if you just without an agreement and right, if you want to control 51, under companies that certain decisions require more than 75% shareholders approval. If you have 76%, you have absolute control.
So for what combination we should look at? Because you
what is your intention?
Have money startups, right? So,
what is your intention? Do you want to control the company? Do you want to let someone else control the company? You
want to
have
I want to control the company. We both co-founders here.
So between the two of you should definitely have more than 50%. And have an agreement where there are certain rights given to you. Because if you hold more than 75, then chances are not many people will come and invest in your company. But that necessary. But if you want to have some sort of the controlling stake in more than 50%. Any further?
The last line you said was that if you don't have more than 75%, then chances of investment is less.
Because if someone else has 75%, I know that my rights are restricted with respect to that company. So I will probably be very apprehensive of I've known people who invested and then the agreement then will have various rights given through the agreement to that 20% or 23% shareholder.
So as an investor, they generally will like to dilute it to somewhere around 60 to 40 or 50, that is.
See, there are investors, depend on the kind of investors, these institutional investors that are there, very often they will take about 30%.
Okay.
But they make us draft the agreement in such a way that 30% in terms of the rights that they have is as equivalent to 89%. So even a small decision will require their approval. So the liability in terms of 30% is less, but because the contractual, the controlling power is with them.
Okay.
So it's just not the numbers, it also how it is defined in the agreement and finally the articles, that will define it. Yeah, just a quickly on kind of types of investors. I think a lot of startups initially have individual investors, friends, family, some godfather coming and putting in money. Then there are these angel, what is called as angel investors, and finally a sort of a venture capital investors. The problem in the first, particularly the first time, I've seen the first arrangement being totally informal. Someone has put in some money in some bank account and believes that he holds some shares for that money, but nobody knows which account that money has gone into, nobody knows what purpose that money has been used to. And then when you come for the second and third round of type of funding, you suddenly realize that he's made paisa diya tha, so he should be holding the shares. But nobody knows where that money has come from, money has been used for. So these are typical types of investors. I think in all cases, as I said, it's better to have as formal a relationship as possible.
So what is the ticket size of investment of these investors? Like,
there's no defined ticket size. Generally, the first round is, when you're starting up, when it's an individual investor, size is obviously much lesser than what a venture capital funding will do that. A venture capital funding, just to give you, an example of Crader, who was one of our clients. They had an initial investment by friends, family in about lakhs. They just closed the funding round last year from Fidelity, which was about $12 million. So varies on the type of business, varies on the type of investor. If there is an individual who is ready to invest that much amount, you wouldn't probably go to the first stage.
The first stage, so.
Yeah, I think now just flipping sides over, and if I'm a lawyer or an investor who wants to invest in a startup, what are the kind of things that they look for? Clear information, I think, on business and stakeholders. Now it's very basic. But as I said, a lot of times you have investments from friends, families, and you don't know. You say that you're holding 10%, but there's no document or evidence that. Clear information on business. What are your business? What are you actually doing? What is your what is your business plan? These kind of things is something that the investors look on. Clear information on all previous agreements. Again, something that we've experienced startups who have consulted and allotted shares on the basis of a one pager saying that I'm allotting you X share for this and you're putting in this money. That is something, it was not stamped, it was it was not reproduced in the articles, it was not properly executed. Those kind of things are not acceptable to investors at all. You need to have clearly documented arrangements, clearly documented agreements. If you are giving shares or rights to individuals on the basis of money that they put in, clearly, that should be clearly spent out in a formal agreement. We spoke about compliance. No investor will ever invest in a company which is non-compliant. Every investor at a first stage will ask their lawyers to conduct a due diligence on the investee company. And if they find that that there's large-scale non-compliance, every investor will sort of run away. And of course, I'm sort of repeating myself, all arrangements that sort of need to be documented. And that means even loans and if you're availing of advances, if you have consultants working for your company for whom you are going to allot money, all those things need to be documented in the form of the agreement. Right.
Advances like deposit, right?
Deposit is a separate term. advance, what, yeah, I mean, generally deposits and advances, but what I meant was the example that Sir gave.
That's
in terms of you have a consultant who you said, I'm going to pay you off in 2 years.
Okay.
Those kind of things, everyone will say, it's a document time. Where are the terms and conditions with respect? They don't want someone to stand up tomorrow and say, this was actually promised and you are giving me something else.
Okay.
And that's an issue with that. Right. When we do a due diligence, and although our scope is sort of restricted to sort of a legal due diligence, what investors look into it, you know, what is the viability of investing in a startup? What is the market looking like? Is the market conducive for me to invest? Because every investor will look at some sort of a return over a period of time. And in that sense, the first thing they'll do is look into the market and how feasible the business is. You know, they will also look at, you know, once the due diligence commences, how much of a scope I have to negotiate with this guy in terms of my rights, in terms of his rights, and in terms of what we are going to achieve going together. And then, of course, they look at obtaining information about the target. The target being the startup in which the investor is investing. They then prepare a checklist of information, and of course, if it's a venture capital fund, they will have a separate sort of entity doing a financial due diligence and separate entity doing a legal due diligence. And a lot of times when we are sort of doing due diligence with startups, we find a lot of issues that need to be rectified. There might be certain non-compliances somewhere, there might be certain arrangements that are not documented, they might have certain service agreements that may not be documented, they might have employment agreements that are not proper, employment agreements may not have clauses, they might have agreements which are not properly stamped. And so the investor will say, look, these are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 issues with your company. I'm ready to invest, but let's have an agreement, you know, which will evidence all of these that you need to rectify. So sometimes they might ask that existing agreements to be amended so that their interest is captured. So you might have an employment agreement with one of the key employees, which might not have, for example, a non-compete clause. And an investor might say, I want a non-compete clause. So you will probably have that agreement amended. You might have an agreement with with one of your vendors or your service providers whose terms may not be acceptable to the investor. We will do a due diligence, the investor will say change the term, these terms as well. And hence, you know, you might ask for an existing arrangements to be amended. A due diligence usually results in the final agreement prior to investment being modified significantly. And one of the things that will happen is an investor will seek representations and warranties. Those are basically guarantees from the startup founders about certain things. So one of the basic, as always asked, is we are conducting business in compliance with applicable laws. They don't like non-compliance. You know, all our agreements are properly stamped and all our arrangements are properly documented. Me and my founder are the only shareholders. There is no other shareholder apart from this. There's no one who owes money to us. There's no other arrangement that we've captured apart from that, the ones that we've shown. These are kind of things that the investor will look into. And of course, they will very often come back to these startups and say, this is the information that we have. You know, is there anything else that you would like to disclose? And on the basis of that, a lot of startups actually, through their legal advisors, submit what is called as a disclosure letter. So, you know, there might be something, they might have claimed at one stage that we are not aware of loans from anybody else. But suddenly they find out anyway, director, at one point of time, he had, you know, advanced a 2 lakh amount to us. So then they'll be disclosure letter saying, yes, we've said this, but, you know, there's a 2 lakh loan that has been advanced. The summary of all this is what the investors want is transparency. Everything to be crystal clear, all information.
What if something is missed out and there is some loan which after the investor takes over, it's revealed?
Yeah, so that ideally should not happen. And that's why I say that everything should be documented. But if it's documented, you would not miss that out. But
there are a lot of companies,
investors
desperate to, find an investor.
Investors are very finicky about these kind of things. Because if they invest and then they realize there's actually a loan of X amount or a liability of X amount, they actually in their agreement have termination clauses of these kind of things. If you do not disclose this, it's a misrepresentation by you, they do not like it. So it's always advisable to have some sort of a, it's always advisable, not something, as I said, disclosure. Having things that are not in place is not a problem. That's what I've experienced. So long as you disclose it. Hiding things is a problem. You know, if things are not in proper shape, investors will go that extra mile and maybe let's rectify this. If they see there is a, there's an opportunity in the business.
But there are, don't you see things like,
when you need the cash, you utilize it and then you disclose it. Things, you know, already are out of control of the investor. The investor has to, you know, go down.
I understand, sir, but it's always better to disclose that. I've had experiences with
investors. I'm not about doing it. I'm saying, if I am an investor, if I am going to, you know, I am going through this, you know, think that somebody is seeking information from me, I've invested, and then later on I come to know that there is some liability which was not revealed.
I've had instances where investors have walked out.
How will I walk out? Because that money which I have given is
already
used up.
No, so that agreement will have that provision.
Let's make it a lawyer.
No, I mean, if you look at different, if you're talking about individual investors, you know, individuals have various ways of recovering money. Some legal, some not so legal. But I'm just a couple of times. So an individual investor said, give me money, otherwise you face consequences the way I want, because you know, certain promises made, certain disclosures made, which are not right. If it's a venture capital fund or an institution, then it's even worse, because they are high market network companies with high market lawyers. They will ensure that, because if I'm working for a VC fund, you know, typically what happens is I will go to my bosses and say that this is a good company to invest in. Let's go down. They go through all the route, and then tomorrow something goes wrong. My job is at stake, because I've asked the fund to invest in it. So they will actually take that extra step to ensure that our money. And in fact, if you not disclose something as well, it can also lead to criminal liability because it's a misrepresentation. So the advice is to disclose it as much as possible, and if something does slip out, then just go and try and negotiate different terms so that it slip out doesn't affect the relationship.
Any example where you've seen the valuation actually go up once the due diligence came out that
typically, valuations are worked out at a term sheet stage, which is before the due diligence. And typically, they do not alter in any way, either up or down after the due diligence. In certain cases, I've seen go down because they mean significant liabilities, so the cost has gone sort of goes. But up. Any other questions? Yeah, so I was going to come to this. Typically, when an investment takes place, there are four stages. The first is, as I said, the term sheet or a memorandum of understanding, where an investor will say, I'm interested in investing in you. Let's sign a term sheet where I, you know, we sort of agree on terms and we'll then proceed that. An MOU or a term sheet generally is not a legal agreement. So just a sort of a commercial document, an indicative document on the basis of which the parties are agreed to proceed forward. MOU and term sheet will have causal like confidentiality. Because if I'm allowing someone to come and do a due diligence of my business, he should actually have non-disclosure and confidentiality. And then there'll be a due diligence stage, typically a financial and legal due diligence. Sometimes it's an asset due diligence if they have some high value with assets. Then comes the agreement stage, definitive agreements. Those are the final agreements which capture the relationship. Maybe for subscription of shares, maybe there'll also be a shareholder agreement which will define the rights of shareholders.
That's where they insert those extra clauses.
Absolutely, yes. And those clauses will be inserted. There will be a timeline given for the company to rectify everything. So let's say typically it's about a 30 days time. And then you come to the day of closing, where the company will evidence that everything is now fine and normal. And on the day of the closing, the investor will wire the funds and share certificates will be allotted to the investor to evidencing his acquisition of shares. So this is typically a investment transaction takes about 3 months.
Now from a company which is raising funds, from their perspective, company is doing your due diligence, everything has been clear success. Few months down the line, or some time passes, the investor, the company, the VC fund, is not in a position to raise funds for their investment purpose. And they have committed to this company of making certain investments. So in this case, in a way, this VC is going bankrupt. So how does that work?
I mean, the transaction just...
That's the
transaction. Typically, the term sheet will have a clause which says that if the for either party, if the transaction is not material, then, and the cost incurred by the other party would be reimbursed by the other party.
No, I'm saying investment has been done. There are certain follow-up investments which are done, like tranches.
Huh.
So I'm saying first tranche is
that's
done.
A tricky one. Okay.
And the second tranche, the VC goes belly up.
Right.
So what happens in that case?
That's a tricky one because that then what happens is generally they will continue to hold the shares. Because the moment a consideration comes, you allot shares. So I've invested 10 rupees, I've got value shares for the value of 10 rupees. I've promised 6 months down the line, I'm going to invest 10 more rupees. And you're saying I'm not in the position to invest that second round. There might be, under the agreement, there will be a termination clause. But very often, from a practical purpose, startups will say, let me just work around that. The other one has gone couple, but let me work with it. But an agreement will have a provision that if this guy, if the investor fails to fulfill their obligations, then they have a right to, there will be typical transfer provisions of the shares as well.
So in the third market scenario, that is what we are seeing with a lot
of
in fact, companies.
To be very honest, a lot of investors are not coming for exit rights to us. So you might have a buyback option by the company, you might have a promoter buyback, a founder buyback. Those kind of provisions are there, but a lot of times the promoters or the founders also say that whatever is there, let's work around with that and then take it forward.
When the termination starts, then will the shares be given back?
See, exactly. First, you'll have to first have the buyback option
the
or the company
promoters
buying the shares option. And then you will sort of proceed with the terms.
So everything has to be part of a definitive agreement.
Absolutely. And generally, yes. I mean, in terms of drafted by the lawyers, generally.
Is MOU, is the MOU or term sheet a legal document?
No. Unless specifically mentioned by the parties that it's a legal document and the appropriate stamp duty is paid on it, and the intention of the parties is that it should be considered a legal document, then it is a valid finding. But typically, without that, courts have always said that these are not. Term sheet is 90% of the time, but 90% term sheet is not. It's a commercial document where I'm saying these are the terms on which I'm going to invest.
I've heard many people talking about MOU. Even MOU doesn't stand as a...
So as I said, MOU is a slightly upgrade on the term sheet.
Okay.
If the parties specifically state in an MOU that this is a binding, legally binding, enforceable MOU, then it might hold the test of the court. But also depends on the MOU. In this kind of thing, an MOU may not. But there are a lot of other things the parties enter into an MOU. In that scenario, perhaps it will be a legally...
So these documents, they become legal only if the stamp duty is paid. So even if the terminology is term sheet and you pay stamp duty, it may be still
legal. And the intention of the party is to make it
legally.
If the intention of the party is to enter into term sheet 6 months after that, we enter into a definitive agreement, then it may not be considered a legal one.
Okay.
If you sign a term sheet and the next day you close the transaction by allotting shares, then it might be considered as a legal one.
Okay.
But you cannot call someone to court on the user term sheet. Very unlikely that court will
report. Okay. Two questions. Can I create two term sheet documents with two investors? Today I make a term sheet document.
You can, but typically the first investor will always have a clause saying that you cannot negotiate with the other investor.
Second question. What, as founder, what are the things I should look for while creating a term sheet document?
I'm coming to that in the next slide.
This is a lot of the actual change on the MCA side for the overall
value. So you just file, there are certain forms for allotment of shares or transfer shares.
A new share. That's all I need to know.
So there will be supporting resolutions.
Right.
There are supporting documents. For instance, there are certain compliances that are required if you are, I'll actually come to that. We'll also capture the next. So I'll highlight that. Yeah, I think this. I sort of you had asked this question and I've addressed it. But the structures in terms of what you can probably have a controlling stake, or you can have a minority stake. If your agreements are, even in the minority stake, there's something called as an affirmative right section in the agreement. An affirmative right basically means that I may have a minority shareholding, but you're not going to take, there's a laundry list of decisions, and it says you cannot take these decisions without my consent. So I may have a minority stake, but without my consent, these things cannot happen, and that's defined in the agreement. So even if a minority stake, there's nothing that much to worry if your agreement has an affirmative right section. You have a controlling stake, you control the company basically. But as I said, the investors will then probably, if you have a controlling stake and investors have a non-controlling stake, they will have these rights in the agreements. And one of the things that some of the startups do is merge the big entity. A merger is actually a a legally defined procedure under the Companies Act where the bigger entity or one entity eats up the other entity and the other entity no longer left. So everything is transferred to the final merged entity. Yeah, so you know, some of the clauses in the agreement that we have is what are the kind of securities? Securities here being the either shares, you know, there's something called as a convertible security under the Companies Act, where today it actually does not give you an equity share, but you put in the money and over a period of time it gets converted into the equity shares. Investment amount, how much amount is the investor putting in, how much shares are you allotting to the investor on the basis of that consideration. Exit rights. Tomorrow I want to exit the company, the investor wants to exit the company. What are the rights you're given? When can he exit? Can he exit tomorrow itself? Today he invests, tomorrow can he exit? Does he need to minimum stay in the company for a minimum period of time? If he exits, what is the value that he's going to exit at? Every investor will define a value which will be some percentage of the investment amount that he will look at when he's exiting from the company. Every investor will also, particularly institutional investors, will require you to have a business plan. And when there are institutional investors involved, a business plan is always a part of the agreement. And they say you work for 3 years on the basis of this business plan. And there cannot be a deviation of the business plan. Any deviation of the business plan is actually a ground for termination. So it's one of the more critical business clauses in the legal agreement. Board representation, how many directors are going to be on the board? How many directors from the founders? How many directors from the investors? How is the board going to be divided? Is there going to be a chairman? Is the chairman going to have a casting vote? How is that going to work out? So that's another important issue. Affirmative vote matters are also called a reserve matter. So if I have a minority shareholding in the company, then I define a list of actions that will require my consent before proceeding ahead. So I have a minority shareholder, one of the items would be you cannot change the business plan. You cannot change the nature of the business. You cannot change the board representation without consulting. You cannot change the auditors without consulting. Transfer of share, one of the most critical items. Investor comes, today I have built a startup, a business, an investor comes. For some reason he wants to transfer my shares. Who can he transfer it to? What if he transfers to a person that I don't like? What if he transfers it to a competitor that I don't want to come? What do I do? How do I protect myself? And should I put a right that says, if you want to transfer, you come to me first and tell me I want to transfer so that I have a chance to buy it. Can it transfer to any individual, any entity in the world? Those are transfer, transfer rights. And an investor will ask what is called the anti-dilution of pre-emptive rights. Today I'm holding 25%, tomorrow someone goes and allots more shares, my stake gets diluted. So an investor will say, at all points, even if you allot new shares, I want to maintain my percentage at 25%, 30%, whatever it is. So these are some of the critical points that are captured in the agreement. Just to come back, I think to come to your question now, sir, in terms of the regulatory angle, the forms, there are two ways that you can offer shares from a regulatory perspective. There's what is called as the rights issue, where an existing shareholder will offer a share and he declines it, and it then goes to the investor. There's a procedure specified, a form under it. And there's something called as a private placement. So you offer shares to specified private individuals or companies that the board has approved. There is a procedure, very technical procedure specified board, but basically to answer your question, then forms have to be filled, there are board resolutions approving this procedure that needs to be uploaded. And once all the forms and the resolutions are in place, and the documents are in place, then the MCA will reflect the share. Critical part, and in terms of startups and allotment, the second, the private placement is a procedure that very often they follow. And one of the most important thing is that there has to be a separate bank account when money is coming in for this. You cannot mix it up with the existing working capital bank account. Money has to be kept in a separate bank account, and only when shares are allotted can the money be then used for capital growth. I've had so many clients who have not followed this. Money has been used up, shares have not been allotted, money has been mixed up with the accounts of the company, and there has been a problem. And then there are certain other compliance requirements in terms of you need to issue an offer letter. There has to be a valuation report to work out a valuation that has to be done by a registered valuer under the Companies Act. And of course, as I said, filing of the requisite forms. Some of the things that investors look at after closing, what are they going to do? Is identification of key employer. If two or three people are driving the business forward, if they are involved in the operation of the business, the investor will always ask for those employees to stay with the company. So very often investors actually ask for new employment agreements to be executed, and which will have, you know, a lock-in period for those employees, or will have a non-compete, or will at least ensure some sort of representation that the employee stays. Very often the employee agreement will have what is typically allotment of shares with the employees. There are also scenarios of good leaver and bad leaver. What happens? A bad leaver is someone who does some damage and leaves, does a fraud in the company and leaves, commits some sort of a misdeed and leaves. In that scenario, his rights may not, the company may be more stringent in terms of rights. Good leaver is someone, mutually someone leaves, someone does good for the company and then walks away, retires. In that case, he will still be allowed to exercise his rights. Very often, there's an ESOP scheme that people like to sort of have a clause for. They typically keep a pool of shares that will be allotted to different employees. It is considered as a sort of incentive for employees to continue working. And that may also be a clause. Intellectual property, very important clause. Who owns the intellectual property pre-investment, and who owns the intellectual property post-investment? It's very critical. Very often in startups, particularly dealing with devices and applications and stuff like that, individuals own the intellectual property rights. So the business is done through a company. The investor will ask to transfer the IPR to the company. The company should own the IPR. It's a very critical clause, because tomorrow what happens if this guy decides to walk away? He should have a right to take away his patents or IPR. So it's very important to negotiate the IPR rights in terms of when the investor is coming in. Some of the other sort of standard agreements, there'll be a confidential agreement, a non-compete, non-solicitation agreement, to ensure that the founders, when the investor comes in, do not start a competing business. Investors are investing in the business to ensure that this business grows. The founders should not have their attention somewhere else. And as I've already spoken about the intellectual property side of it, if the intellectual property belongs to the individual, the founder will ask for that intellectual property to be transferred to the company, and that will be the IPR assignment. I think this is one of the last slides, in terms of the practical experiences that I have seen. And I feel some of it is already been discussed at length. In terms of awareness of legality or agreements and the term sheets, I've had startup founders coming to me and say that they have allotted shares to some investors or some individuals, and on the basis of term sheets, on the basis of one page or letters, I think we need, it's always good to be aware in some respect in terms of what is legally binding, what is enforceable at all stages. Debt and equity awareness of laws, when someone invests, typically when you issue shares, shares have to be issued in return for that situation. Loan, who can give a loan, who cannot give a loan, those kind of things are also important. I think we'll discuss that. In an agreement, the pricing of the shares, transfer rights, exit rights, and of course stamp duty, and the thing that I discussed, that every sort of agreement that the rights of a shareholder needs to be incorporated in the articles of association. Thank you. I think that's in brief my presentation.